First, Jay Baba, I'm so happy to be here with you again. In the summer of 1956, Meher Baba interrupted his seclusion for exactly 30 days to do a very special job. And that job was to travel around the world. He went to Europe, to Australia, to America, and out of that 30 days, he spent 3 weeks in the United States. He asked Charmy to document that trip on film. The program tonight, since Charmy can't possibly cover all of her experiences, is going to focus on that 1956 trip. And by special request, the focus will be on Baba's visit to California. However, there will be probably some question and answer period afterwards when she will entertain questions. To cover the material quickly and to see some lovely footage of Baba, we will see first about 20 minutes of a film that includes footage of Charmy and also footage of Meher Baba that Charmy took, and she narrates behind it. And that is Meher Baba's arrival in the United States in 1956, 7 o'clock in the morning, July 20th. And then after that, we will see Meher Baba arriving in California for about 15 minutes.
Because Baba wasn't going to sit still and pose for you. I mean, forget it. It wasn't going to happen. You either got it or you didn't. That was the end of it. And 3D recently did something with my husband that was one of the cutest things I've seen. Many years ago, I can just remember his name, the man who built the Golden Gate Bridge, or at least he was supposed to have, came to the head of the Bank of America, where Duncan, my husband, works, and asked him to finance the bridge. It was, you know, and it was during the Depression, and in fact, the day that they released the bonds for the bridge was the day the Depression hit. Mm. And nobody would buy them. I mean, he tried everything. He couldn't get the money raised to even start it. And so he came to Mr. Giannini asking him for help, and Mr. Giannini gave it to him. Well, we got involved in when they celebrated the anniversary of the bridges being built, in putting up a plaque, a brass plaque, down at the entry to it. It's down in a little park there. You walk down in a parking lot on the San Francisco side, and there's a little path goes off from that, and you'll see great big granite boulder. I mean, and having to move this tons of boulder in there was a trip and a half. And 3B did the plaque for this, commemorating the two men and what they had done. And if you look very carefully on the right-hand side up above in the clouds, you'll see Baba's face. So,
that's wonderful.
Talk about subliminal messages. So I thought that one was really cute. But, you know, we said people had been waiting so long. The thing was that same car I asked Baba, couldn't I drive, was the one that Elizabeth drove him in when they had that terrible accident in Prague. And Saroj called Mother and me right after the accident and said that Baba wanted us to come. Well, we dashed madly for the phone, and Mother dashed for suitcases and started packing, and my father was waiting downstairs to take us to a wedding out in New Jersey. So she packed, and I phoned for plane tickets, and they said they only had two, and I said, that'll do it, we'll take them. And half an hour later, I mean, or 15 minutes later, we came dashing down the stairs with the suitcase, and my dad, where are you going with that? We're going to Oklahoma. You can't. We've got to go to New Jersey. Sorry, Dad. Papa's been in an accident, and off we went. Well, the reason it was kind of weird was that they were having an airplane strike that was starting that evening. So, I mean, these last two tickets were really important. And we got into Oklahoma City. I mean, it took us hours and hours. We flew all over the United States, as far as I could figure out, you know, clear down to Texas and back up to Oklahoma and so on. But we finally got there. And I remember going up about 5 o'clock in the morning to this bleary-eyed man at a desk and saying that I wanted to find out how I could get a car to drive down to Prague. Prague? Absolute blank, you know. We went through this about 3 times. Oh, you mean Prague. That's the one. So we arrived there somewhere around breakfast time and got into that little hospital. And I mean, it was really just terrific. Meru, you know, had a sprained wrist on one side and the other side was broken, and she had a cracked ankle and the other side was sprained. So, I mean, she couldn't feed herself or do anything. Mara had this terrible concussion. The whole front of her skull across looked like an eggshell that had been hit. I was just cracked into pieces all over, and a big flap torn off her forehead. And all the time that she was laying there, she just kept saying, Hari Baba, Hari Baba, Hari Baba, over and over and over and over. And Elizabeth, bless her heart, she's so staunch, and she wouldn't let them treat her or do anything for her until they'd already taken care of Bob and the girls. So she, they found out, had, I think, broken shoulders, if I remember. And they had put her into a cast, some kind of a cast. And I just know that the next day or two, she was complaining bitterly about the pain in the morning, that she hurt so badly. And they finally took her in and took the cast off, the insistence of all of us, and re-x-rayed her. And turned out she had something like 5 or 7 broken ribs. I can't remember. It was a lot. And they had to redo the whole thing and put her back in. And Monty was the one who was least injured. She had slid across the car, so she had burns on her from friction burns, you know. And she was just inconsolable. She just asked, why couldn't she share in Baba's work? How could he have left her out of this, you know? And finally, Baba said, oh, you want to share in my work? Well, all right, there is something you could do. Oh, anything, Baba. I want you to keep silence until we get back to India. So Mani happily kept silence all the way back to India, practically. So then one day while I was there, they said they would like me to go do some laundry for Baba and the girls. So I said, I'd be happy to do that. I went out. They said, it's out on the sidewalk outside. So I go out to take a look. And I mean, there was a mass of laundry the size of this platform and then some, just all, you know, the bloodstained things that came from the accident. So I found a nice little antique laundry place where they even had hand wringers and scrub boards and big tubs that went down the length of the room where you could soak things in cold water, as we used to do to get stains out, which was wonderful. And I kept doing those, and then I'd run back to the hospital and feed Meru and go back to the laundry again. One day I had to leave. And I thought, my goodness, they don't know what they're doing. But there were some ladies from the town there who were so sweet. They kept referring to us as the people from the accident. I mean, every place you went, it was, oh, you'd like some flowers? Well, you're from the accident, aren't you? Yes, we are, you know. So the head of the restaurant would say, well, you come over to my house after dinner when you're finished, and I have a big magnolia tree, and you can gather armloads of magnolias. You'd go into the little grocery store. I mean, they were wonderful. And well, did you have any little soft berries that maybe Mara might be able to eat? Oh, well, Not really, but I did get two baths. And I put them in the icebox for my dad. You take them. You're from the accident, aren't you? You know, I mean, it was that kind of thing everywhere. And these townswomen came in and took all of this laundry. I came back and just my jaw dropped because it was all folded and neatly done and pressed and put on in a shelf. And I said to the lady, "My goodness, you didn't do that, did you?" "Oh no, some of the ladies from the town were here, and they knew you were from the accident, so they they were just precious." And eventually, Baba asked Mershta and me to go to the West Coast. One of the times when I had a real problem with his board, because he kept dictating, "I want you to go and tell them that their patient waiting will bear," and I kept reading it, "bitter fruit, Baba?" "No, no, no, no. Do it again. Finally, will bear better fruit." "Oh, all right," you know. So we came out here to Los Angeles, and everybody came in one after another to us just after that accident when we were going through, and talked to everybody then. And then later up in San Francisco, where we had a group of very elderly ladies who had patiently for years been waiting for him to come, and of course then he couldn't come. So we were going, "Are they going to live until he comes again?" You know, it was just every one of them did. Not one of them missed the next visit. They all got to see him. And we were just so happy and pleased for them. So anyway, that was the history of that one before we got back to the East Coast. Now let me see, we left off at Myrtle Beach and here and up in San Francisco. One of the funny things, I didn't often go to the Monday night group. I mean, we were busy enough, but I did go now and then. And one time I remember being asked to tell about Bob, and I had gone to describe my trip over to England with him. And the dancers, Margaret Crass dancers, had volunteered to set up a program of ballet dances as a concert to help raise some money, because Bob at that time was one of those few rare times when he said that we could send money over to him because he was going to feed the poor. And so on, he had them all making up these packets of cloth and of food to give away and so on, so that as they came through he could see that each of them got these to help them. So the dancers offered to put on a concert, and they thought about that for a little while, and some of our former more evangelistic types, I guess, said, "Oh no, we couldn't do that, because the only date that they would be free to dance was a Sunday. And you couldn't have dancing on Sunday. This would be terrible. I mean, how would that look with Mayor Bob? I mean, mustn't do that." So what tickled me about it was when we got out to San Francisco on the trip with Baba, here was this little room, and he at one point said that he wanted to have the dancers perform for him, but he didn't want anybody else to come. He was going to have them dance. And the day that he picked for them to dance for him was Sunday. I said, "Well, we do get these hang-ups now and then." It was fun. Then at one point, I think down here, it might have been at Ojai, Baba went through a whole room of us who were sitting. No, it was up in San Francisco, that's right. He went through an entire room of us, and I remember that I was sitting out sort of on a little porch saying, "This one will come to India, and this one will come to India." And he was very careful. He went through every single person. So next opportunity, this one would come, and so on. Well, I'm clear, just outside the door. He's missing me. He went through every person in that room and out onto the porch before he ever said a word about my going. So I thought that was cute. Finally got to me. Loved it a lot. up in the San Francisco area, he went over, spent maybe 2 hours or 3 hours over visiting the home of Carrie and Joseph Harb. He went to quite a few homes up there. He went to Don Stevens' house and said he could get rid of it. He went to Mershda's house and said she could get rid of it. He went to Joe Harb's house, and he sat in Joe's chair, and I was yelled for quickly to run in because he wanted a picture of him in Joe's chair. And Joe was allowed to go with Carrie over to India for a while to stay, so that was nice. I'm trying to think where else. He went, he took the children one day with all of us out to Muir Woods. And we just had a lovely time chasing him through the redwoods there, you know. And at one point, it was one of the prettiest scenes I ever saw. There was this huge, tall redwood right next to a little stream that went by. And he sat down with his back to the tree against it. And everybody else was fanned around him like a semicircle. I mean, it looked so pretty. And I, as usual, was running, trying to find some place to get a good shot of the whole thing. And I got out on a little bridge that crossed the stream and realized, well, I could get a perfect one if I could just stand up on the bridge railing. But there was no way I could do that with the camera. Not without, you know, being afraid I was going to drop it in the drink and that would be the end of the trip. So Herman Alvarado came along then, and he was a seaman. And he said, oh, I'll do it. So he grabbed the camera and zapped up onto the top rail, balancing pertly, and proceeded to shoot a few feet above, counting to 8 carefully, which was how everybody was taught to do it, except someone like me who had studied still photography. Me, I just let the camera run down. When the camera ran down, that was the end of the shot. Thank goodness, because otherwise we would have had very short pictures all the way through. So Herman got a count of 8 in and then started to go up the redwood tree. And I'm going, no, no, Herman, no, keep it on Baba, no, it's going up to the top. So we have a lovely shot that lasts for about 1 split second, it seems like, on the film. But at least it was enough that one could make a still photograph if one wanted to. And it's only due to Herman that we got anything at all. But I laughed. I mean, I thought, well, it was probably a good thing I didn't learn anything about motion picture photography because I would not have gotten what I did. Another place we went to was down at the Fred Frey's home, Fred and Carolyn Frey in Hillsboro. And later on, of course, that place self-destructed because they had gotten some rugs in that were treated with something fairly poisonous that caused all of them real health problems. They had to move out. Eventually it got cleaned up enough so it was sold and went elsewhere. He went up to Ludd's house on one trip, I know, up in
Canfield.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of the name of the mountain. Mount Tamalpais. He lived way up on top of the mountain there. And, of course, they sold that not too much later. Well, all of that, you sit and wonder, well, how come, you know, every place he went, they go. Well, I was thinking back to Myrtle Beach. One day he had taken us all out on the beach, and he wanted us to pick up seashells for him to bring back to India for Mara. Well, I didn't think much of the collection we were getting that day. The shells looked pretty scruffy to me. I didn't think they were very pretty. But we got them up to the house, and there was one shell he picked out that was specially for Mara, and it was the most crocked-up old shell you ever saw. And somebody explained to me later on, well, of course, that's all an avatar or a perfect master even is interested in, is something that is so worn out. It's used everything it's got. So, I mean, it began to make a little more sense. And I know one day when I was working up with Bob Emmerich in Davis, he came running in and he said, oh, Charmian, we've been doing it right. Doing what right, Bob?
Well, you've got to understand, really what Baba wants is for us to be totally worn out, to use everything we've got, just as hard as we can use it. Until that happens, there's nothing, you know, no place to go.
And this from the chap that I was always having to stand on when he sent in proposals or anything else, count on a vacation. Give us some sick leave. Well, he was doing it right. I was wrong. One day, Baba also went up to Coit Tower with all of us, as I said, and the children were there. And it was there at that time that Phyllis was there. And Baba pointed down to the south and he with her. And she got the message that she was to go live down here. So that's how she came to Los Angeles to live. When we were out at the Redwoods there in Muir Woods, one of the children got left behind. Now, I'm not sure if it was at Muir Woods or if it was at Coit Tower, but one of them was left behind in any event. And a friend of mine who was traveling with us, Sparky Lukes, cornered the child, found them up there, and stayed with the child and brought it home in a taxi later on after we had already left. But when Baba got back to Holiday Inn and he counted the children around, took a look, where is this one, you know, and the fur flew. We had been very negligent, and so he then appointed Sparky. So every time you see the kids from there on out in any of the pictures, they're always clustered around this one blonde girl, and Sparky was the one who was appointed to keep tabs on them, make sure all of them were there when we got on the bus or in the cars, whatever we were doing. Anyway, he was there about a week. He went down to the old Sufi center that we had. Of course, we got rid of that not too much later. And nothing is forever around the Avatar. I said to somebody the other day, we try and save all these trees and things that are out in every forest around and every place. And the fact is, if you were a tree, you wouldn't want to be stuck in that form forever. You would want to go on to something new. Get that energy freed up to do other things. So we'll learn someday. But we had him there for about a week, and then sadly had to take him out to the airport and let him go on his way off to Australia.
He didn't stay long at the ice skating rink, did he?
No, he didn't. I mean, half the time he plays
for
anything.
Shakespearean marionette show.
Yeah.
Just came
in. He'd come in and he'd stay for maybe one act, if that. Maybe a couple of scenes. And then you'd hear a little rustle and Baba would be gone and he would have left word, we were all to stay and enjoy the show.
Yeah.
But a couple of times I can remember him being in theaters for prolonged periods. Oddly enough, I think it was Dial M for Murder that we watched in London, which had been put on by one of Delia's brother-in-laws. And he stayed, I think, almost all the way through that. But he loved to go to theaters and to movies and to things like that because he had the entire audience concentrated on one thing and he could get his licks in really well. The other place that he loved to go and sit was in the airports. He always wanted to get to the airport at least 2 to 3 hours early. And then he'd get out in the main terminal, wherever there were tons of people rushing backwards and forwards and going on their way. Because again,
contacts in the airports. I said,
yeah.
You could see they were looking at them.
Yes. And people would just be fascinated with him sometimes. Then others would go by without even noticing it. I know when we got on the plane to go to Europe, I was fascinated because we had a ton of photographers and people around, and what they were doing was following Miss Universe. And some gentleman in wrestling or bodybuilding who had taken a big title, not Arnold, somebody else. Could have been, I don't know, but it was whoever had just gotten it that year, and so they were both there posing, and she was doing her poses with him, and they were all photographing them, and in the background stood Bob watching this all.
That was very cute.
We got him onto the plane then, and spent a very strange night flying towards England, because every so often there were some little children on the plane. One or two of them would come down the aisle to go to the lavatory or something, and they'd come back and they'd see Baba, and they'd just gradually move over an edge in front of his seat. And we had several seats for him, because with the leg injury he was moving it up and down all the time. You'd see it fly up over the back of the seat every so often, because he was trying to get the muscles built up in it and keep it flexing well. And these little kids would come up and they'd just get lost looking at him. I mean, and just you could tell they were just loving him, you know. And their parents would come along and say, "What on earth are you doing bothering this gentleman? You shouldn't be here, you know." And they'd take the child back to the seat, you know, while they and the child go to the lavatory again. A few minutes later, they'd be over in front of Baba's chair. This went on all night long, as often as they could. The parents couldn't figure out why on earth were they, you know, playing with this peculiar man down in the front of the plane. Little children see things very clearly sometimes. And Baba also, whenever he was flying, it didn't matter where he went, he was always in motion, and he'd be reaching out to one person or another. He'd give this one a pat, or ask somebody else how they'd slept, or, you know, how were they feeling? Had they eaten well that day? It was always something going on, constant stretching towards others around him. And as we were traveling, I mean, it was customary always to let Baba leave the plane first and, you know, enter places first. So I was constantly, "Baba, may I go out first in order to take pictures, you know?" "Oh, yes, you know." He'd dispatch me on my way with, who was the young man who was with me at that point, who was Darwin's son?
Knowles.
And he was paddling along too. One of the problems that I constantly had was that every place we went, the professional photographers would come in, the Dave Garraway crew in Myrtle Beach. Mr. Rosenthal, was it, in
yes,
the Delmonico? Not the Delmonico.
He did the Delmonico. Rosenthal.
Well, I was thinking of where the Longchamps, where the party
and
was.
Both.
And they immediately corralled my light bars. So they took the light bar, and I'm running along behind them with no lights, trying to to still take pictures. So it was not an easy trip. And when Baba walked in those days, I mean, Jim has slowed a lot of the pictures down so that we could see all of the gestures and the motions that Baba made. And it's really quite nice. But in reality, when you look at the original film, I mean, he is going a mile a minute. And these great big men who were traveling with him, I mean, Sarosh and the others, none of them were small. They were great big guys. And they were running half the time behind him, even though he was walking. And he walked always right from his hips. I mean, it was like watching a pair of pistons go across the...
I was going to ask you if you ever looked like he was floating when he was moving so fast.
Well, it didn't, I mean, there was no bobbling. It was like watching a machine go, you know, just...
So trying to stay out in front of him to take film, I was just bizarre. And he also would get a big kick out of things. We'd be down. We went down one day to at Myrtle Beach. We went down to Brook Green Gardens, which is a very, for those of you who haven't been there, it's a very beautiful garden that Huntington established down below
Myrtle. Huntington,
wasn't it?
Yeah, it was established by Huntington, one of the Huntingtons,
and they dedicated this place to American artists, both poets, and I mean, there's sculpture all over it, beautiful pieces of sculpture with poems attached to them. And Baba went down there with the whole gang of us, trailing after him through exhibit after exhibit after exhibit. I'm trying to photograph them all running through here, and like Baba would come up from, it was one area that was kind of sunken a bit around a pool, and then they came up a ramp, and I'm standing, I've gotten just in the right spot to take the picture, and Baba turns right on a path that I didn't even know existed and disappears in the distance with everybody between me and him. Then he comes out, I'm looking, where are they going next? You know, I went running over, got into a pathway, ready to take a shot of him coming towards me, and unable at all to figure out when was he going to emerge, you know. All I could do was stand there with the thing. And he comes up, pops up practically out of nowhere, and then gives me a broad wink and turns on another path I didn't know was there. It takes everybody off in another direction. So it was kind of a cat and mouse game, even though I was supposed to take the pictures.
Charmian, I had a couple questions. Did you have private meetings with Baba?
Well, Mother and I were often in there because she was full of questions. You know, when she brought the idea of the Sufi order over to him, it was, I'm bringing the order to you, Baba, to deal with. I didn't want to do this. All I ever wanted to do was sing. Baba says, not this lifetime, you know. In this lifetime, you're meant to run the Sufi order. Yeah. This is not your lifetime to sing.
Yes. She and Baba said, Ivy will do great work for me.
Mm-hmm.
I think it would be good to tell us a little how, with the publication of God Speaks, Life of the Spirit, were you there when they were working on that?
Oh, yeah. I even heaved too to do editing here and there where I had to. It was just a monumental job. Anybody who ever has tried to publish a book on Baba, my hat's off to them, and I cry for them. It's one of those tasks which is just daunting. I mean, poor, oh, I don't know, dear, it was way back there. Way back.
Did he bring it up in 1948 when you were there?
I don't remember anything about that then. Most of what was going on at that point was just even reorienting the whole order, because Baba put out that whole charter for us that we had to follow, you know, and gave us all, you know, what we had to do, repeating his name each day and doing the meditation and so on and so forth. And so, I mean, there was a lot going on, and she was full of questions. Unlike me, I'm not very good at thinking up questions, but she was just full of them because she had to be, and she was seeing all these things that could go wrong, the kinds of things that had to be protected or dealt with. And, I mean, everything from centers on through, it just, as you all know, having gotten a center, it's just not that easy.
Right.
And, I mean, we were down... Adele and I are old enough. I mean, I'm pushing 70 now. I don't know where Adele is, but the fact is,
we're not going to publicly announce.
We're not going to tell.
It's in the 70s, all right.
But you know, we can remember back to where the number of people who belong to her group, the Monday Night group, or to the Sufi order were down, I mean, you could count them on the fingers of your hand.
In the beginning.
Yeah, and Baba kept saying to Mershta, but Ivy, don't worry about that, you know. You do your work, and
and have your classes, and even if nobody comes, you do it. And he kept saying, and thousands will come to you. And every once in a while, Mother would look at me and she'd say, thousands? Thousands? You know, I mean, this went on for the longest time, and all of a sudden they were coming out of the woodwork. People were coming in the strangest ways. I mean, one chap, I said to Adele last night, I just remember this one chap got into somebody's closet at some point, and up on the shelf was a copy of God Speaks, which fell off the shelf and hit them on the head. And 2 or 3 hours later, they emerged from the closet halfway through God Speaks. I mean, the craziest stories you have ever seen. And of course, it was a lot of it was all our flower children were arriving. The first thing Marsh do is off with the hair, back to school, get a job, do all these mundane things that Baba was very insistent we all
had
to.
She had a special talent with young people. That was her best.
I think she practiced on me a lot. I just remember getting lots of criticism over the course of my life. It wound up great friends. I mean, we had a lovely life together, particularly as we got older and got over arguing. And it was so clear to us towards the end of her life how much of it was just roles. Literally role playing. I mean, one lifetime. Baba had said one time that the reason I found it hard to take orders and direction from her was that in another lifetime we had been sisters in China. And I had been the elder sister who had raised her. And so I was still trying to raise her in this lifetime. Yes, in India one time.
What occasion was that?
It was just before we left India, the first time we went to see him. And he asked us to sing a duet. And the two of us looked at each other hopelessly because we had never sung together. She had studied.
She loved singing.
Oh. And she had a beautiful voice. It wasn't a big voice, but it was very true and very beautiful. And we had never sung together, I mean, except riding in a car or something, you know, car songs or something like that, which aren't exactly what you think of with the avatarists. So we wound up singing, I think, 3 verses of I've Got Spurs That Jingle, Jangle, Jingle. He seemed to.
That's all that matters.
Right. I mean, who cares? The only problem with Baba liking things, he was always asking people to tell him a joke or tell him a story about a saint. Well, if you tried to tell him a joke, then you had an awful time because you always were sure that he knew the punchline before you ever got there. So you're chattering as fast as you can go, trying to get to the punchline and get it out and hopefully get a giggle. And with saints, you'd get one of those vacant feelings of saints? Who? What saints? Do I know a saint? You know, and you'd see people looking frantically around trying to figure out who could they talk about? And gradually, they'd go back and dredge some small saint out of their mind that they could tell him about. And we'd talk about that for a little bit, and then maybe somebody else would come up with another one. He'd let everybody tell their stories. And then when everybody would get all through, and people would be praying, I hope they don't talk about mine, you know, before I can do it. You know, it's, who else can I talk about? So when they'd get all through, he'd look at everybody very seriously and say, well, now that was nice. Now let's talk about real saints.
Real saints.
And he'd bring out, you know, some papers by St. Francis or St. Catherine or St. Therese or St. Augustine or, yeah. Sometimes it was things connected with Rabi of Basra. It was another one of his favorite saints. Things would pop up. I always remember when Francis came, Brabazon came the very first time to meet Baba. I was there, and Francis came in, and Baba said, "Now I have three Francises." And he said, "St. Francis of Assisi, St. Francis of..."
In which Francis?
I don't know, in Francis Brabazon.
When was that?
Xavier, the one in...
That was... It was in Myrtle Beach, way back there. My sense of time is
that's
gone.
That's when Francis Brabazon went into the first time in Myrtle Beach?
Yes.
Right.
See, he had come to the East Coast, to San Francisco. Mershda Martin wanted to go over and meet Baba. She knew she knew at least that he was what we would call the Ketubi Irshad. This is the hub of the wheel of the perfect masters. I mean, that was the minimum. So she wanted to go to meet Baba. So she asked Baron von Furstenberg, whatever, in Australia, who was the Sufi sheikh there, to send one of his men to go with her to India. And he sent Francis. And then she became ill. She eventually died of cancer, I think of the throat, if I remember.
Yes.
And then Mother became the Mershda. But in the meantime, Francis was staying around all this time, waiting to go to India with her. And then he worked for a while there in New York, first in our building, then at one across town where the Monday night group met.
Winterfeld.
Yeah, because Winterfeld had run our building on 67th Street, too. And so Francis was there for a long, long time. Finally, Baba came on Sahabas, and Francis went down to Myrtle Beach to meet him. And he walked into his first meeting with Baba, and Baba greeted him, and they talked for a few seconds, and then Baba said, "Now, Francis, will you do what I ask you to do?" And Francis said, "Yes, Baba, anything." Baba said, "Well, Francis, then I want you to leave and go back to Australia now, right away." Francis, bless his heart, stood to his feet and started to walk out the door. I mean, he was that obedient to what Baba wanted. And Baba said, "Oh, Francis, not that, not now, you know, later on." But he sent him right away. They made the arrangements, and Francis had to travel down to, I think, New Orleans to catch a boat back to Australia. And it was a good thing he did, because he barely got back there before the Baron died. And then Francis became the head of the Australian order. Except then Francis asked Baba, couldn't he go live in India with him? So he left Australia without a leader at that point. And he went over and became part of the Mandali in the ashram there. But I had a lovely time with Francis the whole time he was in New York. Among other things, people might not know about him, was that he was an enormously gifted and accomplished musician. And I think, wasn't he... either Yehudi Menuhin or Yasha Heifetz or one of those. He had a sister he used to play with, whoever it was. It was one of these top violinists. Used to go, whenever they were over there in Australia, they'd go up and play with Francis. He built a little center there up in the hills with his own hands in stone. And he was amazing. And he wrote poetry, as you know.
I was wondering if you wanted to tell them the story of the egg, the incident this morning.
Yeah, I couldn't help it. I had ordered a Japanese breakfast this morning, and I picked up this bowl, and here was an egg, barely cooked. I mean, it was just, they had run it through the hot water at least, sitting in this little bowl, and I had, oh, it takes me right back to India. When I was a girl, one of the things that I hated, I mean, I just absolutely, an egg had to be so disguised it was a cake before I would touch it, you know. Don't give me eggs, doesn't matter. So when I was in India, I had been very ill. I'd been in Cairo before then, and I got very ill there. In fact, I was unconscious for about 3 days while they got medicine in me and stuff and got me back on my feet. So I arrived in India absolutely worn out.
Was that your first?
Yeah.
First
I was so tired. I mean, you cannot believe how exhausted I was. We had about 3 days with company people and things going on in Bombay. And then finally with Mayorji, who was quite sick at that point, we drove up to Ahmednagar in what we call Pipalgaon. And when we got there, I think maybe the second morning or third morning, I can't remember, Dee and I were trying to figure this out the other day. We had to get up, I think around 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock in the morning to go to breakfast. And we would eat out in the garden. Well, they woke me up and I went, couldn't I just sleep a little while longer? Kind of gurgle. Whoever it was, it could have been Mani or Gohair or somebody, went tearing out of the place down to Bob and said, Charmian's very tired and wants to know if she could sleep a little later. Baba said, of course, tell Charmian she can sleep until 9 o'clock if she'll eat the breakfast I send her. Sure, Baba, anything, whatever you want. I'm out. So 9 o'clock, I present myself dressed and ready to go out on the porch, and here comes that beautiful little man, Kaka, with a tray in his hands, a beautiful tray, lovely fresh fruit, a flower and some bowls on it. It comes up and is set down in front of me. And in a bowl is, I don't know if it was one or two eggs that had never even seen a pot. This was not my idea. And I said, Kaka dear, would you by any chance have any like, vinegar or oil or something, you know, anything that would kill the taste, I thought. So I added a little to it and then went, this is not going to work. It won't work because all it's doing is making it bigger. So I finally said, well, all right. Picked up the bowl, whoop, down with the eggs. And Mother was sitting there looking at me like this because she knew how I reacted to these. So I ate them. I didn't think any more about it, but lunchtime, Kaka came by. We're out chatting on the porch, and he goes down the group of us, and he said, well now, is there something I could fix you specially for lunch? So Marshta gave her order, the others gave their order, and he finally hit me, and I said, oh, I don't know, looking up, maybe a poached egg, Kaka, that would be fine. You know, went on with what I was saying, and Mother looked at me. Dinner time came, just before dinner time, Kaka came by again, and he said, well now, could I fix anything special for you? Went down the row again. Oh, I don't know, Kaka, maybe a couple of scrambled eggs, that would be fine. You know, and Mother, at that point, couldn't stand it. She came over, she grabbed me by the shoulder, she said, Charmian, for heaven's sakes, do you have any idea what you're saying? But somehow, Baba had lifted that dislike of the eggs. Yeah, and he never lets you hang on to hang-ups. I mean, what Alan Cohen used to refer to as our marshmallow hang-ups, I mean, he took them away.
So Charmian, about the egg this morning, did you eat the egg as was, or?
Ask my traveling companions, they watched me. It went down.
Charmian, what was your first impression upon seeing Baba at that time?
Oh, I was terrible. I mean, here I was, I'm a Bennington student taking psychology, studying philosophy. My mother was going off to meet this faker in Fakir in India. Heaven knew what she would get into. I was being forced to go along. I had a very nice boyfriend in Saudi Arabia. Why was I having to go off? But okay, all right, I'll take you. You know, my enthusiasm from Gramercy Park had totally departed. But I mean, after all, I had to go along to protect her. Daddy wasn't going to go. So off I went. And of course, I got into the room where Baba was. And felt totally humiliated. My mother went up there. She cried, and she cried, made a scene. You'd see this 18-year-old feet out in front of her, just rigid with disapproval. And Baba let this go on so long, and he started talking to her for a while, and then suddenly he looked around, and he Charmian, innocent. And why, I don't know, but it just struck a chord in me that produced a waterfall. I'm there bawling my head off. Why? You know. I think for maybe 3 or 4 years after that, I was still battling. Now, why did I take psychology if I'm going to believe that's God on earth for... That's ridiculous. You know, I'm going through this whole scene in my head. And all the time down here, I'm going, I don't think this is working. I'm not going to win this one. So I was very glad when I lost. Sent to go take my first bath there in India. And they had a little kind of fold-up rubberized canvas thing about this big across that you just climbed in and sat in, and they'd have two buckets of water, hot and cold, with a ladle to pour over you or wash your hair with. So having gotten myself soaked, hair soaked, the rest of it, bang, 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 comes the knock on the door, and it's Delius or somebody saying, quickly, come, Charmian. Baba wants you to take some pictures. So there I am, leap out of the tub, throw on some clothes in a hurry, race out the door, grab the camera equipment, run like crazy to where Baba was with Mershta. And what had happened was she had brought, thinking to bring some little present for the girls and everybody, some silk scarves, which had been picked out by somebody else. And there was one of them she particularly disliked. It was a very bold, vivid pattern that in those days she wouldn't have been caught dead in. So, but she finally went, well, there isn't time to do anything about this. People's tastes vary. Somebody may like it, you know. So when we had gotten there, as one always did, she gave the whole stack to Baba, who then would distribute them to whoever he wanted to have them. Well, when they called me down there that day, he had gotten the scarves out, and all of the girls had different scarves, and they had all made different kinds of turbans, including Baba. So they wanted me to take a picture of them and their things. And about then, Narina remembered that Mershta had brought some hats with her that were pretty fanciful. Because Mother was noted when she was younger for her pretty shoes and the matching hats she used to wear. Anyway, you'd have to see some of them to believe it, but they really were something, smashing kinds of hats. And she, Narina asked, said, oh, Baba, Ivy has the most beautiful hats with her. You must see them. So she was sent off to go get the hats, the big hat box, and bring it back and take out all these hats to show him. And so I took the pictures of all of them in their turbans and her in her hat and so on.
And Baba's turban.
Yes. So when it was all finished, Baba reached up and he took his scarves off of his head and he handed her one. And of course it was the one she... he had made it beautiful for her, but it was that one that she had liked. It was very cute. Then she kept it, you know, ever after. I think it's still down at the center somewhere. If you're running a mile a minute, you don't have time to sit around meditating with the master. And if anybody even threatened to, I remember one time Dom said, well, this time he was going to Myrtle Beach to Sahavas with Baba, and this time he wasn't going to do anything but sit at the feet of the master and soak it all up. 3 days after we got there, I think it was, it passed, and I finally saw Don again, and he was green. Don, what happened? Baba put me in charge of rescuing all the lost luggage from Charleston. Running back and forth all the suitcases delivering them to everyone. You know, I mean, forget it. There was none of this sit around adoring. Bob, it wasn't going to happen.
Were there a moment that you felt his godhood, that God is
in
the form?
Yes.
Well,
it was very funny. I mean, it was a strange kind of thing because here I'd been fighting all this while. Yeah, I'm not into this. That's what you think. I'm not into this. Yeah, that's what you think. One night I went to sleep and I had a dream of Baba. I was in India on a hillside and he was up above near one of the trees with the men around him, and they were talking. And I started walking up the hill to get closer to be with them. And suddenly, I mean, it was like Baba stopped everything, and he walked down that hill, and I mean, he looked like God coming at me, you know, and warned me to stay back, not to interfere. Go away, so I did. But the feeling of majesty that he presented me with in that dream was such that I could never get over it. I couldn't forget the feeling of that. And I mean, knowing who he was at that point. And I mean, that made my 180-degree turn. I gave up on the spot. That was it. More than I could tackle.
And how old were you then?
I was in college. I must have been about 18, 19, somewhere around there.
19 or 18?
Yes.
Were you with him when he was in Arizona or New Mexico when he met the Navajo Indian?
No. No, that was an earlier trip.
Oh, it was.
Yeah.
Question here.
Do you have any other remembrance of Agnes and Baba and Mirabelle?
Well, Agnes was like, I mean, there were a number of us then who were with Baba every chance we got, you know? And we had a lot of encounters with Agnes over the years as she was trying to raise funds for Ojai and so on. But Baba, as was the case with Mershta's house, was very clear with Mershta that this was not something for her to get involved in. And Agnes did not take that lightly. She didn't like that one at all. And yet Mershta couldn't quite say, you know, stop already. It was not an easy relationship, although Mershta loved her. I did too. And certainly she worked so hard trying to get that place together. And of course, I mean, we were having our problems. We had to get a center together and do all the things, the publishing, the rest of it. Ask Lawrence Ryder how easy it is to get a book out on Baba. Your whole life falls apart in the course of it. I was thinking, you know, that scene where I had to go photograph the hats. Some years later, when I was over in London with Baba, and one day I went down to my room, and it seemed like we were going to have an hour or two free, and I, having flown for hours and hours and hours and been busy with things backwards and forwards, thought, well, maybe I could wash my hair. And then I went, well, as soon as I get my hair all soaked up, he's going to call me. I just know it. So anyway, I took off my dress, I wet down the hair, got the soap on, got all the way through even rinsing it and thinking, gee, I made it. When bang, 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 the door knock comes, Charmian, Baba wants you right away, you know. And I threw on very quickly a banker's coat I had with me, Chinese banker's coat, you know, with frogs down the front. It was purple. And threw a towel around my head and made a turban and went running up through the staid British hotel up to the floor Baba was on, hoping nobody would see me. And here was everybody kind of parading out from the rooms, going down the hall. A couple of them were taking Baba to the room to put him down on the bed. And as I came up, Baba said, "Ah, Charmian is in her Chinese movie." And then it turned out that what he wanted was for me to watch the door while he rested. Because everybody had errands to do. Nobody could stay with him. I should watch the door. So everybody went off, and Baba had been tucked in bed, and the door shut firmly, and there I was in the hallway of the hotel in my bench, sitting cross-legged. And I'm going, "Oh my gosh, well, I'll tell you, I think every drunk in London came down the hall. If it wasn't somebody drunk, it was somebody crazy." I mean, it just went on and on, and each one of them got confronted with this wild American woman, all going, "Shh, shh," you know, trying to keep them hushed up long enough for Baba to get a nap. And a while later, after I was sat there for about an hour, suddenly I heard this funny noise coming from someplace in the hotel, and I couldn't tell where it was, but it sounded like the chains on the Ghost of Christmas Past making their way up a metal staircase to the upper floor where Baba was. And they kept getting closer and closer. Clank, clank, clang, clang, clank, you know, and the sound of footsteps. And finally, down at one of the halls that led away from the room, the door opened, and out comes a man, and there was all this creaking going on, too. He comes out the door with an enormous wicker commode, the biggest wicker commode I have ever seen, you know, with the wicker just going creak, creak, every place he's going. And what they had was a metal pan in it with an entire tea set packed in it, which was going clankety, 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 clank against this thing. And this man is absolutely determined he is going to deliver this commode to Baba's bedroom, to Mayor Baba. And I am going, "No, you're not." Wrestling with him, literally in the hallway, in my turn. "My companion is sleeping. You can't go in there," you know, in hushed tones. And finally, I persuaded him to set it down next to me in the hallway and go on his way. So then we've got everybody coming down the hallway watching this nice lady in the purple banker's coat with the turban on her head sitting next to a giant wicker commode. Eventually, the people came back, the Madeline, Rado, and the rest of them. And Rado, and they... Baba about then, you could hear him clap, you know, and they all went in, and they came back out, and you could practically hear Baba laughing in the background. Said to Charmian, "Baba said that he's had the best rest he's had in years." And you knew that he was watching every moment of this comedy of errors in the hall. I loved it. It was such fun. He could always think up some excitement for you. I one year, I was asked on one of the Michigan Terminal System conferences to one of the professors said they would like to know a little bit about the people who use the system long distance. We came over a little hill, and there was the sign. So by the time we stopped, we were just beyond it. And way down the road, maybe 100 yards or so beyond us, was a guard post where they would stop the cars to check. And the soldiers came flying out of this guard post with guns leveled at us, yelling, "Stanishway, stop, stop." So we did. As we were turning, I mean, we'd already started to turn the car around to go back in the other direction. All my Arabic friends said, "For heaven's sakes, why don't you keep going? Just run." And we weren't brought up that way here. I mean, you know, the police tell you to stop, you stop. So the next thing I knew, I was in jail in Jeddah, looking out the window, a little donkey going by, poor little guy on it, thinking how lucky that man was. He was able to go down to the market, you know. And I just remember seeing that, oh yes. Baba said, "Charmian can go to jail for Anita." Right. And I might have known it would be for a religious offense.
How long did you stay?
In jail, I was there for that was the night before, so I was there the bulk of the next day. Long enough for it to get wired up to Riyadh and the king to send down a message. Ivy Duce had been in jail and they were holding her in jail, and he sent back a message, "Let me go." And then the local emir was tied up with various things at that point, and so they were chasing the message around with him. It was a wild night. That would take the rest of two evenings for me even to begin to tell you what went on. At one point, I just remember walking up through the dark alleys of this street trying to get to the Ramco house to go to the powder room.
It didn't work to say we're not Christians, we're Sufis?
Oh, that would have got me in real trouble.
Oh, yeah.
Forget that. Bad enough. Bunch of mystics running around. That's a very... That country is, after all, very puritanical. It's the center of the faith. I mean, that's where Mecca and Medina are. And the king is the keeper of those two cities. And I wouldn't have embarrassed him for anything. In fact, I wouldn't have tried to go to Mecca. I mean, forget it. I have too much respect for the faith to do something like that. But it was a wild scene. So I did go to jail for Anita. That scene in Arabia was really very scary too. I mean, I just remember crying and crying. I had tears running down my cheeks because, among other things, the mother had just been out to the... I was staying downtown at the house. They were staying out at the American Embassy, my mother and father. And she had come in to see me the day before to let me know that my father had had one of these stomach things that you can catch easily in those areas. The doctor, when he went over him, said that he was very concerned because he thought that he might have a heart attack any minute. That it was very important he not get excited or upset over anything. Of course, I couldn't think of anything that was more liable to send him off than his daughter being in jail. They had said they were going to chop the heads off the next two people they caught trying to go to Mecca. It was not fun. And there was nobody at the jail when we first got there who spoke English. And so this young officer and I, at one point, finally decided we had to get to the interpreter. We tried to persuade the lieutenant there to come with us and go. There was just no way, there was no action unless one of us took action. So I stood up and started down the hallway to the outside of this place. And my officer friend said, who was the American Air Attaché there, he said, tried to get the lieutenant to come along. And I finally got to where the stairs down the outside of the building were, and took my first step. Took my first step down one of those, and down in the courtyard at different stages around it were some of these young Saudi army officers. And the guns came up. I took another step. The guns were cocked. I put my foot out to go the third step, going, "They've got to get out here, Baba," and rags came flying out with this lieutenant, who was then screaming, "Stanishway, stop, stop," And he had them lower the guns, and then finally we got down and into the courtyard and went out and got in a car. And the lieutenant understood who it was we were after, so we got over through these dark streets. This was the middle of the night, to the house of this interpreter that we knew. And they went up and rapped on the door with the guns. The two men got out, or three of them, two soldiers and the lieutenant, and started banging on the door with the guns, and somebody said something from inside. The next thing I knew, they kicked in the door and went right in over it. And in the meantime, this lieutenant had said to me, "Now, if they go in, you leave and go up to the house." So I was left finding my way through these dark streets, not knowing exactly where I was going, but some idea, and finally got up to the house. And I was so concerned about this, that that they were coming after me, and you know, had was there a major problem of any sort, that I kept looking out over the balcony instead of going to the powder room. Big mistake. When we got back, to they did come, and they picked me up and went back to the jail. And this little lieutenant was so sweet. I mean, he came in, and eventually they started carrying rugs and furniture down, and they decorated a cell for me and made me a medjugorje to sit in. And then they very carefully showed me how to lock the door from the inside so that people couldn't get to me. I thought it was very cute. And finally, there was a point where I had to go to the powder room. So by then, the captain had arrived on the scene. And he was determined to question my friend Rags, and did so for a while. And finally, he turned on me and wanted to know who I was. And I said, "I was Bint Duce." And he said, "Duce? I knew a man named Duce in New York. Terry Duce?" And I said, "Yes, that's my father." Well, the top of the building practically blew off. He took off running for the local emir, because my father had been a friend of the kingdom for many years, you know. And he took off running to tend to that. But in the meantime, then the bit with the medjugorje, the whole thing. And I really thought they were awfully sweet to me, given everything. But in the meantime, when the captain went to go, I went with him, and we went flying around the town trying to find, with Ragsfong, another car, and he got lost, so we lost him totally. And we're still trying to find this telegram that has come, that they've arranged for. We finally got back over by the jail, still having not found it. And I stamped my foot and said, "I have got to go to the ladies' room. There is no ladies' room here. You are going to have to let me go back to the Aranco house and go there." And they were very, having done this kind of thing, you hear the noise, tape's finished, they're switching, you know. Anyway, so I finally got back to the Aramco house, and they let me go. He sent me up with a driver and said, "You'll come back." And I said, "Yes, I'll come back." And I did. Went to my little medjugorje cell up on the upper floor, and eventually, when I arrived, the room was filled with gray-bearded gentlemen sitting on the floor in the captain's office, because they were then, it was the ulema had come, and they were discussing letting me go, reading the telegram and so on. And eventually they came in and put me in another car and took me out to the airport, where my father and mother were waiting, because they had a plane ready to go to Egypt with us. We were planning to leave that day. So much for Baba sending me to jail for Anita.